Pioneer Sideline is back for week number 2. I'm your host, Blaine King. The Super Bowl is set, and we have coverage of what happened this past weekend in both the NFC and AFC championship games. The volleyball team had some major recruiting signings. We have the story on that, and of course, we have your national and regional sports to talk about. But we're going to start basketball first. Both basketball teams hit the road this past weekend, and we have the news on what happened in both Kentucky and Indiana. I'm going to toss it over to Megan Masiosi, who has a story on what happened with the women. Megan?
The women's basketball team traveled to Kentucky to take on River State's conference opponent, Brescia University. Point Park dominated in the first half and was up 28-18 going into the third quarter. This was a good defensive game by the Pioneers, especially since their offense was lacking. They only shot 27% from the field, but Brescia was worse, shooting only 22%. One notable standout was Jania McFadder, who had a game high of 18 points. The Pioneers won 56-47. On Saturday, the women traveled to Indiana for a game against the IU Southeast Bearcats, and this game was a heartbreaker. The Pioneers have gone 12-0 when they keep their opponents under 60 points, but not this game. IU Southeast was up 33-25 at half, and the Pioneers' offense looked terrible in the beginning. But after second-half adjustments, the teams flipped. The Pioneers' offense was on fire and tied the game at the end of the third quarter. With 10 minutes left, it looked like the Pioneers were going to win, as they had a 5-point lead with 5 minutes left to go. But IU Southeast had the final push and was up by 3 points with only a minute left. After a couple of free throws from the Pioneers and a couple missed free throws from the Bearcats, Point Park had a chance to win the game, but the ball bounced off the rim as the horn sounded, handing Point Park another RSC loss. One bright spot for the Pioneers this game was McFadder, as she became the 14th player in Point Park women's basketball history to reach 1,000 career points. The Pioneers start a 4-game home streak this Friday against Asbury University, where they look to bounce back from their loss.
Now, Megan, Pioneers have been struggling a lot on offense. What should they do to kind of fix that problem?
Right, so the girls need to, whenever they're dribbling down, they are turning the ball over really quick once they get in the zone. So they need to start passing the ball around a little bit more. Like I said, they were really bad in the field of play. But I think once they start passing it around and shooting, maybe a couple more shooting drills in practice would help as well. But really, they just need to pass the ball.
Now, on the other side, you mentioned that defense has been a strong key for this team. Which ways can defensively can Point Park even improve, if there's any?
So Coach Grinnick, he likes defense. That's his main thing. So I just think with Bailey, she's doing really well for them as well. I think once they just mesh a little bit more, they'll be better.
All right. Thanks, Megan. Now we're going to take it to the men's side of the ball, where they have had their struggles this year, but especially struggles on the road with a 1-8 road record. Josh Krupp is here today with the word if the Pioneer struggles continue or somewhat evaporated. Josh?
Thanks, Blaine, and you know as well as I do. We all know that feeling. You know there's an exam in class, but you also don't know. You also know that you didn't study, and you're not really prepared at all. So what do you do? Well, you show up to class and you hope you can at least get a couple answers right. Well, the men's basketball team went into this weekend knowing it had a pair of exams on the road, where they have failed, as Blaine said, consistently this year. The first of those two contests was at Brescia, a team that was 2-6 in River State's conference play entering the game. The Pioneers at least brought their pencil to the exam, but they spelt their name wrong in the top of the paper. Point Park trailed 45-26 at halftime and shot just 30% in the first half. The 19-point halftime deficit was too much to overcome. Brescia topped Point Park 84-71 to win its third straight RSC contest. Rashawn Roberts had a team-high 18 points and 10 rebounds for the Pioneers, establishing career highs in both categories and registering his first career double-double. Point Park had to travel next to Indiana University the following afternoon. The Grenadiers were receiving votes in the NAIA Top 25 Coaches poll and were 8-1 in the RSC entering Saturday. This time, Point Park didn't bring a sharp pencil to the game. You know, in fact, they didn't bring any of its top scorers. The Pioneers remain without Saeed Allen and Kenny Strong, who are out due to academics. They were also without Art Christian and Gavin Rajapalay in this one due to injuries. Now, if you're keeping track at home, that's 51.8 points per game that's left out of the lineup. 51.8. That's also without 121 made three-point field goals on the year. Now, it didn't help that IU Southeast was number one in field goal defense in the nation. They were the best. Pioneers trailed 38-23 at the half and ultimately dropped this one 83-54 with a thin roster on the court. Point Park is now a staggering 1-10 on the road this season. Pioneers have lost 7 of their last 8 games and currently stand at 6-13 overall with a 4-5 conference record. Now, luckily, the next 5 contests are at home for the Pioneers. Then it's 4 straight RSC road games to end the regular season.
All right, Josh, you mentioned that academics and injuries obviously have been a major key in this team's struggles throughout the year. But what else has contributed to the struggles?
This isn't a team that is built on teamwork. It's a lot of the same Point Park basketball we've seen in the past. It's a lot of individual-based. It's a lot of run and gun. And it's not the team we saw at the beginning of this season, and that really hurts them. You know, the injuries and the academic suspensions lead to that. They're not playing for each other. They're playing for themselves. They realize that the chemistry isn't there, and that's really hurting them.
Yeah, and then you also mentioned how the Pioneers' next 5 games are all at home, 4 of which are against RSC opponents. What could the Pioneers do to start creating a little bit of a winning streak?
Well, the Pioneers get Villa Maria on Wednesday, a non-conference game, and then, as you said, the next 2 weekends at home. What can they do? I have no idea. If I knew, I'd be the coach. I really feel for Gabe Bouban, who's taken over the reins. He's had a tough roster this year, and if they can at least be competitive in these games, I think they'd be decently satisfied. This isn't a Point Park basketball team that's going to go far. They might miss the conference tournament. We were talking before the show. That's a very real possibility. What can they do? I have no idea.
And that will be a shocker if they do miss the conference tournament, because they were projected to be at least the number 3 team in the River States Conference
division.
Especially
with the way they were playing at the beginning of the season, after that five straight losses to win, begin the year.
Yes. All right. Thanks, Josh. The volleyball season is over on the court, but Coach Mike Bruno is hard at work with recruiting, and he was able to sign some major top recruits. We will have that report when we get back.
People. We share inspiration, wisdom, creations, and memories. We share what makes us laugh and what angers us. Built on the notion of a free flow of ideas, our country thrives on the freedom of speech. Without it, who would watch over our governing powers? And how would we share our history to make a difference for the future? It's this freedom to share that gives us a reason to listen.
All right, guys, any questions on the script? Are we good to go?
Yep, right.
Should be good.
All right, great. Cool. All right, camera 3 set up right there. Camera 2, right. Use the ball when you're moving this around, but set up for the 2 shot just right there. Weather, how are we doing?
It go rain.
Perfect.
Welcome back to Daybreak. I'm Sarah Mackin with
the real host, Adrian Malone, was seen snuggled up in.
All right, prompter. We got everything in. We're good to go. Key Pro, everything loaded. We're good to go. All right, Tyler. Any questions?
That shot looks fine.
Like 3, 2, 1. Bring up camera 2. Open mics. Cue talent.
Good morning and welcome to Daybreak. I'm Blaine King.
Thanks for tuning in. I'm Aubrey Henkin.
And I'm Aaron Myler.
And this is Entertainment on Point.
Beyonce has surprised us again.
Kanye West just tweeted,
"This was a huge weekend at the box office.
A fan favorite TV show just got canceled.
Guess what band is coming to the city?"
And the award went to,
but did you see her engagement ring?
Her outfit was awful.
I would fire her stylist.
Tune in for all of your Hollywood gossip and pop culture news.
Entertainment on Point.
Get into the point of pop culture!
Yeah. Point Park volleyball head coach Mike Bruno is in the process of losing major talent this upcoming year, so he hit the road to look how to replace that talent. Mike Turk has the story.
Yes, Mike Bruno has been very busy this offseason. After losing Emily Mang, Shiloh Simonson, Kirsten Burks, and Nikki Incortano, he has responded by signing 4 new players to come suit up for him next season here at Point Park. The first and probably the biggest signing was Meg Reinecke from Sinclair Community College in New Knoxville, Ohio. Reinicke will be transferring to Point Park next season as a junior to play outside hitter for the Pioneers. She is a 5'10" outside hitter who can play all the way around the court. She will more than likely be playing the role Shiloh Simonson had the past 4 years for Point Park. Her freshman year at Sinclair, she had a league-high 548 kills in 30 matches. Just to put things into perspective, the leader in kills in the River States Conference last season was Natalie Jones from Brescia, who had 472. Now, the NAIA will be a more competitive league for Reinicke, but I talked to Coach Bruno the other day, and he has confidence that she'll transition just fine. Another player from Ohio that Coach Bruno signed is a 5'9" outside hitter and middle blocker, Abby Miller. She will come to Point Park as a freshman. She played multiple positions for St. Clairsville High School and received an all-district selection her senior year. Some local talent was signed as well. Jada Jones from Keystone Oaks was signed earlier this month. The 5'10" Jones will be a freshman next season, and Bruno is considering putting her on one of the pins. A 5'11" middle blocker from Gateway High School will be filling the gaps of Nikki Incortano and Kirsten Burks next year. Jaslyn Rozier, an all-Whippeal third-team player her senior year for the Gators. She currently plays on a club team coached by Bruno. He told me over the phone that she will be a for-sure middle hitter next season. Rozier's mother actually played volleyball here at Point Park and was elected to the Athletics Hall of Fame. Her mother, Jana Orlovsky, played from 1994 to 1997 and built quite a resume. She was the conference freshman of the year, and then she went on to be selected for first-team all-conference the next 3 years, and on top of that, she earned conference player of the year her senior season. And now Madison Weldon, who was a senior last year, will redshirt and have one more year of eligibility left. So we'll see her back again next season. But the big rumor that is floating around is that Megan Branchick could be returning. Branchick played a key role in the 2015 season for Point Park as she led the team in kills from the right side. She opted out of playing here her senior year due to a shoulder injury. If she does decide to come back, it's possible that we may see Ashley Taylor move from the right side back to the middle. I have talked to Taylor about this, and she's told me she'll do what she needs to help her team win, but she really does like playing on the right side, and her stats say so too.
Mike, how important is it that Coach Bruno is able to sign these recruits to help replace the likes of Amang, Simonson, Burks, and Incortano?
Well, you're talking about four key players on that team from last season. Both your middles, gone. Your starting setter, gone. Your outside hitter who plays all six rotations, gone. Reinicke is a huge, huge addition to this team. She's going to play all six rotations around more than likely. Now, the big question up in the air, who's going to be your second middle and who is going to be your setter? Coach Bruno is considering running a 6-2 type offense, which will put two setters on the court for Point Park instead of one. Those two setters might be Madison Weldon. It's all up in the air because of she had a back injury, and she just had back surgery not too long ago. And Julia Minoski, she'll be a sophomore next year. She played setter in high school for Bishop Canavan, actually led her team to a state championship win. So that's the big question. Who will be setting the ball to these hitters next season?
All right, thanks, Mike. We're going to now look at some regional action that's happening here in the city of Pittsburgh. Rob Gomez is with me. So, Rob, what's going on?
So, sorry, Pittsburghers. Just like I was forced to say to myself in week 17 in regards to my Raiders, you will not have to say the same. Maybe next season. The Steelers were beat by the New England Patriots 36-17. That's right. The New England Patriots are once again the AFC champions. So, while the Pats prepare for their final game in Houston, Mike Tomlin and the Steelers head home and look forward to next season. One star veteran player, however, has yet to fully commit to returning back to next season. While you some might think that it's the soon-to-be 39-year-old James Harrison, it's actually the 35-year-old Big Ben. In his weekly radio show appearance, Big Ben said, quote, "I'm going to take this offseason to evaluate, to consider all options, to consider health and family, and just things like that, and just kind of take some time away to evaluate next season, if there's going to be a next season," end quote. While Big Ben holds his fate in his hands, Le'Veon Bell's fate rests in the hands of GM Kevin Colbert. After suffering a groin injury before even the start of the AFC Championship game, the star running back will be heading into the offseason with hopes of signing a long-term deal. There has been no official word yet from the Steelers, but they do have the option to use the franchise tag on the two-time violator of the substance abuse policy and with two prior knee injuries before getting a long-term deal set. Now, it's time to switch the gears as we move to the ice where the Pittsburgh Penguins have been on fire. The Pens are riding a four-game win streak. The Penguins' win margin has been a crazy 16-3 advantage over the past three games. The Pens beat the Canadiens 4-1 on Wednesday, ran through the Hurricanes on Friday 7-1, and blew through the Bruins 5-1 on Sunday. On the season, the Penguins are outscoring their opponents with a plus 35 goal differential. The Pens are third in the Metropolitan Division and lead the Rangers by 2 points, even though the Rangers have played two more games. Pittsburgh will host the St. Louis Blues Tuesday as they hope to extend their win streak to 5 games.
All right, Rob, with all the Big Ben and Le'Veon Bell situations happening, should Steelers fans have any worry that they could both leave at the same time or one or the other?
I don't really think too much, Ben. I think what the whole deal was about that is that he is getting up in age and maybe he's just kind of like letting, you know, the organization know, like, hey, it's not this year, but it's coming.
So soon.
I'd start preparing. But and as far as Le'Veon Bell, I really believe that they will use a franchise just to get him for an extra year or two. The Steelers, I don't think too much that they're one of the guys that are going to pay these talent position where it comes a wide receiver, running back. I think they're more or less just going to try and find him through the draft and let those players walk and work on the trenches, really.
Okay, yeah. It's going to be interesting to see how this offseason goes for the Steelers.
The Steelers and everyone.
All right, thanks, Rob. When we return, we are going to talk about what happened this week in the championship games as well. And also, sad news shocked the baseball world. We'll have all that when we return.
Here on the Pioneer Sideline, we talk a lot about sports in the studio, but it's beforehand when the conversation is actually interesting.
I hope I have enough powder on. I don't want to be too shiny on camera.
No, Trevor, I think it looks good every week you pull it off.
Ah, thanks, Phil. Man, your hair looks great tonight, by the way.
You sure? Yeah, I mean, I got a new haircut, but it looks all right.
Hey, guys. Does this make me look fat?
No.
No.
Kyle, you look great.
You look good.
Yeah, Kyle.
Thanks.
Sports! Yeah!
You ever wanted to be behind the mic and have the world listening to your show on campus? Well, it's just as simple as joining WPPJ, Point Park's student-run radio station, located on the second floor of Lawrence Hall, right next to the dining services. Listeners can tune in using Point Park's website or through the TuneIn app by searching WPPJ. WPPJ welcomes any new DJs that want to get involved, so be heard. Do you have what it takes?
Well, no one showed up to the show tonight. Follow my lead. In 3, 2, take 2, open mic's Q Talent. Good evening and welcome to UVU News. I'm Josh Krupp. We begin with breaking news out of West Penn Hall. Ready 3, take 3, take lower third. Traffic is backed up in the West Penn elevator line after elevator 1 broke down on the 7th floor. Lose lower third. Maintenance advises students to take the stairs to avoid delays. Ready 2, take 2. In other news, no, you know what? I didn't sign up for this. We need crew. Join UVU. Take alien hand transition.
The NFC and AFC championship games did not go as expected to many. Sarah Macklin has a story on that and some very sad news that happened in the baseball world in our national segment. Sarah?
The matchup for Super Bowl 51 has been set. The NFL playoffs continued this weekend with the conference championships. In the NFC, the Atlanta Falcons dominated the Green Bay Packers 44-21 to punch their ticket to the Super Bowl. Quarterback Matt Ryan led the Falcons with 392 passing yards and 4 touchdown passes. His Pro Bowl wide receiver Julio Jones finished the game with 9 receptions for 180 yards and 2 touchdowns. Now on to the AFC. The New England Patriots defeated the Pittsburgh Steelers by a final score of 36-17 to send them to their record 9th Super Bowl appearance. Patriots quarterback Tom Brady finished the game with 384 passing yards and 3 touchdown passes. His favorite target of the night proved to be wide receiver Chris Hogan, who led the team with 9 receptions for 180 yards and 2 touchdowns. The New England Patriots and Atlanta Falcons will meet in Houston, Texas on February 5th for a highly anticipated Super Bowl 51. Now onto some sad news in the world of Major League Baseball. Another young pitcher's life with a promising future has come to an end. Kansas City Royals starting pitcher Yordano Ventura died at the age of 25 in a car accident outside the city of Juan Adrian in his native Dominican Republic on Sunday. The right-hander, known for his 96-mile-per-hour fastball, helped lead the Royals to a World Series win back in 2015. Unfortunately, the baseball world was struck with another tragedy the same morning when news broke that former major leaguer Andy Marte had also died in a separate car accident just hours before Ventura in the Dominican Republic. The 33-year-old spent most of his career in the minor league with several teams, including the Pittsburgh Pirates Class AAA affiliate, the Indianapolis Indians, in 2011.
Thanks, Sarah. Yes, some very sad news coming out the baseball world with Ventura and Marte's death. Our thoughts and prayers are with his family as well. But we're going to take a more in-depth look of what happened this week in the NFC and AFC championship games. Joining me will be Mr. Paul Daniels. And returning fresh off his volleyball report is Mike Turk. So, gentlemen, we're going to start with the NFC Championship game. And the Falcons defeated the Green Bay Packers 44-21. Big day for Matt Ryan and Julio Jones. Matt Ryan over close to 400 yards passing, 392. And then he had 4 touchdowns in the air, 2 of which went to Julio Jones, who had 180 yards in receiving yards and 9 catches. So what was some bright spots you've seen from this NFC Championship game? It could even be about the Packers.
Bright spots. I think, you know, you have to feel confident going into the Super Bowl, having the number one scoring offense in the NFL, and still being able to capitalize even in some of the hardest fought games during the playoffs throughout the entire way. I thought Green Bay, you know, just the injury bug, finally at the cornerback position in the secondary, caught up to them. And they just weren't able to hold up. And Atlanta's a tough place to play. It's not as tough as in Dallas. It's just not. And they capitalized.
Yeah,
Atlanta just wanted it from the first snap of the game. They went right down the field. They wanted it. Matt Ryan continues his phenomenal career, or his phenomenal year. He has had a good year, or a good career, but he's had a phenomenal year thus far. Yeah. And Atlanta just really wanted it more than Green Bay. And you touched on it perfectly with Green Bay's defensive injuries just catching up with them finally.
Yeah, especially in the secondary. We saw Green Bay secondary start to unravel in that Dallas game, but Atlanta just made sure. Atlanta converted a lot on third down also, and that was a key thing. They had a few third and long situations, and Green Bay could not stop them. And you saw that from the start of the game.
Yeah.
Atlanta was in, I believe it was a 3rd and 8, and they just got the first down, and they just kept driving and driving and driving. How big is that going to be for them headed to the Super Bowl?
I mean, third down is one of the most important downs, I mean, because you have to get it. That's the down. If you don't get it, then you're punting. So, I mean, I think they were like 10 of 13 in the game. Mm-hmm. Like, that's an insane a number of times to convert on that. You have to get off the field as a defense.
Yeah, when you have the weapons like they do, the Freeman in the backfield, the Julio Jones, arguably the best wide receiver in the National Football League, even Mohamed Sanu has stepped up phenomenally whenever Julio draws the double coverage. And they just make it look so easy offensively, and they have all season long. They've really stepped up their game come postseason play, and they were a team that was in question. Are they going to end up choking under pressure when it comes to postseason play?
Yeah, after previous years where the Falcons have been a great team, they lost. First year, Matt Ryan, he lost to the Cardinals. Granted, he was on the road. That was his rookie year. A few years after that, he lost to the Packers at home. When the Packers made that run, lost to the Giants on the road, and they lost to the 49ers in the last remaining seconds in that NFC Championship game a few years ago. So it's good to see that the Falcons were able to get off that hump. Now we're going to go to the AFC side. Turk, I'm sorry, we got to talk about this. When the Patriots defeated the Pittsburgh Steelers 36-17, Tom Brady exposed the Steelers secondary again, tossing for 384 yards, three touchdowns. This guy named Chris Hogan wide open basically the entire game, nine receptions, 180 yards, and two touchdowns. Julian Edelman, you know he's going to get his fair share, eight receptions, 118 yards. What were some big things we saw from this game?
Well, Tom Brady does what Tom Brady does best. He finds the weaknesses in the defense, and he found that in rookies Artie Burns and Sean Davis and really picked them apart. But not even just Artie Burns and Sean Davis. You had Mike Mitchell getting beat on multiple plays. You had William Gay getting beat, two guys who are veterans who should not be letting that happen. Experience, I think, is what really won this game, and having a quarterback like Tom Brady.
And defensively, you got to look back and say, I don't know what the Steelers were thinking with only
playing the zone.
Yeah, playing the zone. And the way to beat the Patriots and Brady is you got to get after them. Mm-hmm. You got to hit them, and you got to get pressure up on them. And I was seeing multiple times they were rushing three. You got to have some blitz packages in there. They didn't do that. So in the first half, they were pretty much dominated. Mm-hmm. And that was pretty much ultimately the game. I mean, they weren't coming back. And then offensively, once again, Bill Belichick, you know, takes the best players on your team, what you do best, and takes it away. So Antonio Brown was really a non-factor in this game. And Le'Veon Bell, of course, got injured, so that didn't help.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that was from start to finish.
And I said, I tweeted before the game, I said that the Patriots can win this game if they take two of the three killer bees out. And they were able to do that with Bell going down with an injury and with Brown just being silenced the entire night. Now, another thing we did see from the Patriots is the fact that their receivers – shredded the secondary. Now, could their receivers do the same against an Atlanta Falcons team that defensively is not that stout?
Yeah, I see both defenses not that. You know, they haven't when they play good quarterbacks, they usually get picked apart. I mean, but Atlanta's side, it's always high scoring for them, and they always try to outscore you. Defensively, they brought on some new players, Vic Beasley, and they've tried to, you know, get some type of defensive line. I think that's their best chance because obviously they're not really a scary secondary as you.
Right. Hopefully, Atlanta really needs to do their homeworks here in the next 2 weeks to really eliminate these slot-type receivers, Bill, of Julian Edelman, these small receivers. And it's going to be interesting to see if this will be a high-scoring Super Bowl or not. It probably will be, but it's definitely something that you're going to have to do some research before making picks here in the next couple of days.
Who has the advantage so far, the Falcons or the Patriots?
I like the Patriots just because of experience.
The Patriots have the advantage. They've been there and done that. Yeah.
All right, thank you, gentlemen. Super Bowl 51 looks like it's going to be another big game, especially with it being on Fox. But the NFL has decided. But the NFL still has to decide who is going to be this year's MVP. That will be the great debate in this week's Case of the Week when we return.
It's been the most unpredictable election in U.S. history.
And on November 8th, we'll bring you the historic conclusion.
Donald Trump.
Hillary Clinton.
Pat Toomey.
Katie McGinty.
America is writing the next chapter in its history book, and UView is your only source for election night coverage. Election Night 2016, live from the Center for Media Innovation, Tuesday, November 8th at 8 p.m., only on UView.
Every human being has a purpose, has a dream to have their voices heard, no matter where they come from, no matter where they go. As an American, it is their right to have freedom of speech. I have a dream that one day this message will speak louder than words, that even the quietest voice will not go unnoticed. That is my dream. What is yours? For more information, visit www.freedomofspeechpsa.org.
All right, and welcome up. We're going to wrap up the show with our case of the week. Joining me will be Rob Gomez, Megan Masiosi, and Sarah Maculin. The topic is simple. It is going to be, who will be the NFL MVP? Rob, let's start with you.
You know, as much as everyone wants to give it to the guy, the same guy over and over, I just can never do it. I have way too much biased opinion to give it to him, and I'm willing to admit it, but I got to give it to Matt Ryan. You know, almost 5,000 yards, 38-7 interception ratio, and the guy just, you know, he's been there a whole season. I'm just going to give them one obvious point.
I also actually have Matt Ryan, but like my second one would be Aaron Rodgers, but I'm going to go with Matt Ryan because he has been incredible this season, honestly. He has thrown 38 touchdowns a season to 13 different receivers, which is a new NFL record. So to me, I don't understand how you don't give it to Matt Ryan because, I mean, he's going to the Super Bowl. And to me, the NFL season starts in September and Brady didn't come until October. So he shouldn't get it either.
Yeah, I also, not to be the third one to say this, but I also have Matt Ryan. I would have given, if, in my opinion, if Tom Brady would have had those four games at the beginning of the year, he would have gotten it just based on what he did for the team in the games that he played, and he set a new record for the touchdown-interception ratio. So I think it would have been him. But back to Matt Ryan, who I think will be the MVP, he just set record numbers after numbers after numbers. Like, he had an impressive season, and he has the best yards per attempt with 9.26 yards per attempt. So that is the best for any quarterback since 2000. That's 17 years, so I mean, it's just the numbers speak for themselves, and he led them to the Super Bowl.
All right, so we're all sold on Matt Ryan. Okay, I see that. I'm sold on Aaron Rodgers. I think he deserves to get it. Granted, he
ran the table.
Yes, he ran the table. He did not just came up a yard shy. But I understand. I understand Matt Ryan. He had close to 5,000 yards, 38 touchdowns, 7 interceptions.
What if Derek Carr doesn't break his leg in Week 16?
See, Rob does make a good point because we could be looking at a different Super Bowl as well or something.
See, but these two, you have to look at that, but you have to also look at these two who I had at Matt Ryan and Tom Brady, number two, they got the job done. They're both in the Super Bowl. Aaron Rodgers, granted, his secondary was terrible, but
you have a run game most of the season.
You can't blame it all on everyone else. You have to take some credit for it. So these two guys got the job. Matt Ryan got the job done. I mean, I say
Trent Cole showed how Derek Carr was the MVP. The second he goes down, his team goes to shambles.
Yes.
I think you could argue who most valuable is.
Exactly.
You could argue that with a lot of teams. You could argue that with the Steelers. You could argue that with the Falcons. I mean,
you can
Steelers,
argue that the with Steelers, the Patriots.
But
I
the mean, Patriots, yeah. the Patriots Chris stayed Hogan, alive, Julian, however.
The Patriots had 3-1 without Brady in the first four games, thanks to Belichick. So
it's not going to be the same.
I mean, I don't know. You got the quarterback?
Garoppolo.
I don't know how to say his name. But what if he came in? You know, what if he was the new Brady?
They would have lost.
What if he was the new Brady?
It's not the same.
What if he was the new Brady to how Brady was to?
But he wasn't.
I mean, that's because he came back. Because Brady came back. Yeah. And what if week five? You know, he gets boom with concussion and he's out for the rest of the season. Garoppolo comes.
Then
back.
I don't think they're the NFC champions.
That's a Belichick deal.
I think.
Then it's about. Is it Belichick or is it Brady?
I would think that will be because of who the Patriots played. Patriots wouldn't have lost their division. they would have won their division.
Yeah.
And they probably would have still ended up with the bye, because the only one that would compete with them for the bye were the Raiders, the Chiefs, and the Pittsburgh Steelers. Now, I think that Patriots get that bye. I think they still end up playing the Houston Texans to win. I don't think that Brock Osweiler, but that wasn't going to happen. But I think that I think they would have still ended up in the same position.
Also, look at the other MVP candidates, Zeke and Dak.
Yeah.
You take one of those guys out. You take one of those guys out. They still have the offensive line behind them.
No, I think it's more of the running game.
Yeah,
I think Dak is good. Dak is a good quarterback, and I'm not saying this as a Cowboys hater, but I think it was more of Zeke of why the why the Cowboys were 13-3.
But you also look at bringing up the point you brought up Aaron Rodgers, and you brought up Derek Carr, which obviously he's not even in the running because of what happened. But why do you think Zeke and Dak Prescott fell down in the rankings? Because their team didn't make it.
I wouldn't say they fell because they didn't make it, because the MVP race is based on the regular season. You can't.
Yes,
I mean,
but you're not going to say it doesn't have a bias towards how they do in the playoffs.
I think they relied too much on each other this season. I think you took one away from the other. Dallas isn't that good.
I mean, but you get the offensive line in the same.
I think you take one away from the other, and they aren't that good.
But you take if you think about it, you take the offensive line. You say you take the offensive line. Neither of them are that good.
Well, I agree with you.
But then you also have to think about this way. The Cowboys had the same offensive line last year, and they went 4-12, whatever their record was. This year, they have the same offensive line and put Dak and Zeke back there. The main reason why the Cowboys were as good as they were was because of Zeke. Zeke won them at least three games.
See,
especially
I would go a little different route there, because they've, no matter what, they've had good rushers. They had DeMarco Murray. They've had Darren McFadden, who behind that line was good with Alfred Morris. You know, all of them have benefited, but Dak, I'd say. A lot of people don't give Dak the credit that he deserves.
Yeah. It's also because he's a rookie. But, I mean, I definitely see everyone's point. And I guess
Derek Carr, MVP 2017-18.
Oh, goodness. I guess the reason why nobody's picking Rodgers is because he didn't get it done, correct?
Well, yeah. I think if this would have been different, I probably would have picked Rodgers over Brady.
He had a great second half of the season.
Yeah,
I'll give it.
I agree. The first half was terrible. But they played Minnesota.
I will also make this point.
It wasn't that good.
He tossed for 22 touchdowns and 7 interceptions in that first half of the season, and then ran the table, not even throwing an interception until in Dallas, when actually Davante Adams, if he laid out for it, it would have been caught or incomplete.
That's not a full season. He still had
Tom Brady missed the first four games.
Well,
so to me, he shouldn't be in this.
No, that's what I'm saying. The fact that we're saying 22 touchdowns and
7 interceptions is a bad season for Aaron Rodgers
I'm not saying it's a bad
season. No, but we just consider it.
I'm saying, but it doesn't compare to the Matt Ryan.
Matt Ryan's numbers as a whole.
Yeah.
Best completion percentage, best yards per attempt, better touchdown percentage, better passer rating.
He had the number one offense, and he controlled it. He was it. So that's why Matt Ryan ultimately deserves the MVP over.
So, okay, last point. We take Matt Ryan off the Falcons. Do the Falcons make it to the playoffs still?
No.
That's a good question. I don't think so. I mean, they do have the weapons when you look at wide receivers. Sanu's had a great year. Julio Jones is arguably one of the best wide receivers in the league. But I think Matt Ryan is commanding that team at this point.
Do you have another quarterback in this league, a backup quarterback that can average 9 points?
Yes.
9 points. Yes. A 136
yes.
passer rating.
Yes. His name is Tony Romo.
No.
As a backup. I'm just saying as a backup.
Okay.
On the Falcons roster. I'm looking at you like you're a little crazy. They've been eating right.
Okay. If we take Aaron Rodgers off the Packers, do the Packers even contend for anything?
No.
Except for the first round draft pick, maybe.
Not even close.
Because that secondary is terrible.
But look who
they do have the star wide receiver, Jordy Nelson. Look at their wide receivers.
If you say Jordy's a star, we can't overlook Julio.
I know what you mean there. I mean, I just think
you'll have no one to throw it to.
Yeah.
Quarterback, it's such a quarterback driven league. I mean, it's nothing mm-hmm. nothing new. But
yeah. All right. That was a great debate. All on Matt Ryan, I'm on Aaron Rodgers. I think Matt Ryan probably will end up with it, though, just because how far he took his team. They're in the Super Bowl. They got that bye. They were on fire all season. They were only stopped one time this season with under 20 points to my Eagles. I'm happy for that. But besides that, he's dominated the league. So I actually do think it's probably going to go to Matt Ryan. I hope Aaron Rodgers, but it's probably going to be Matt Ryan. Well, that is all we have for you for this week's episode of the Pioneer Sideline. Thank you for tuning in, and thank you to all the staff that we had today to help out. Join us again next week as we will have more basketball news and a report on the NFL Pro Bowl. Also, we will preview Super Bowl 51 as well. So join me again next week at the same Pioneer time, the same Pioneer place, and of course, the same Pioneer Sideline. Have a great week, everybody.